Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it. Thanks for being here today. And it's been a long day, and I think there's been some interesting things said, and there's been a lot of questions. One of the things that was said earlier today that sort of concerns me a little bit, it says that these hearings have not found a smoking gun. I believe it's even a warm slingshot. Well, I, for one, and the folks of the 9th District of Georgia, where I represent, are not looking for those things. They're looking for the truth. They're looking for what happened that night, because the one thing we have found, it may not be a smoking gun or a warm slingshot, but we have four dead Americans, and that's what this is about. That's about finding what happened in the past so that we can move forward in the future, and I appreciate your willingness to be here and these families who are willing to do this, because truth is important, even in this town. It's important. I want to ask a follow-up question. Mr. Nordstrom, I want to follow up on a question from Mr. Langford earlier about a March 28th cable asking for more security. He asks you about the intended recipients of that cable. Now, did you expect Secretary Clinton to either have read or to be briefed about that cable?
Absolutely. I certainly expected, given the fact that she had an involvement in the security process, if I could take a step back, by virtue of having the SST teams there, because they were a Department of Defense asset, the process required for that is something called an exec-sec. That exec-sec is literally a request from one cabinet head to another, in this case, State to DOD. That request must be signed by the cabinet head, Secretary Clinton. She would have done that, the initial deployment request, plus an extension in the fall and a second extension in February. She also came out to post toward our facilities, toward the facilities, and saw the lack of security there. That was something that her country team, or she was briefed by the country team as she visited the site. We also saw later there was the attacks against the facilities. Certainly there is a reasonable expectation that her staff would have briefed her on those points.
I think it was you that said earlier, could this be a concern about a DOD presence and an embarrassment with State on a embassy? And a real short answer there.
That was how I took away.
That's why you took it.
Right, from DASLAM.
Thank you. Mr. Hicks, I have a question. We'll go back. It's been asked here a little bit before. In discussions about a permanent presence in Benghazi, give me sort of a quick flavor of what was those discussions like? Was it said, you do this? How was that? How was it going out?
Chris told me that in his exit interview with the Secretary, after he was sworn in, the Secretary said, we need to make Benghazi a permanent post.
Okay.
And Chris said, I'll make it happen.
Okay. Was Washington informed of the Ambassador's plan to travel to Benghazi?
Yes. Washington was fully informed that the Ambassador was going to Benghazi. And we advised them August 22nd or thereabouts.
Okay. Were there any concerns raised from that?
No. In fact,
Given the timing and everything?
None.
Okay. Based on your experiences in Libya, do you believe that Foreign Service officers remain in avoidable danger in such high-threat countries as Libya?
Thanks. I believe that Foreign Service officers are serving their country where they need to be serving their country. And in some places, the risk that they are taking is very high.
But could we, in light of what we are seeing now, be avoidable in the sense of from our lessons learned, if you would?
From a lessons learned standpoint, the security, we need to be increasing our security strength and practices and training. And so, again, I may not be quite understanding the question.
Well, and I think what I'm saying is that what, if you had that situation, what would you need to be done to prevent something like this from happening again? Is that being taken advantage of, or is there still sort of a denial process going on here?
I think that we have more to do than what has been put forth by the ARB and its recommendations.
Okay. So as we move along, and I want to maybe ask you this question that I asked earlier, especially from a security standpoint, because it's something I think that we can flesh out over time, and maybe, Ms. Thomas, if you want to jump in on this, is that DOD sort of influence that has been mentioned by Mr. Norris a couple of times, from the wanting to be permanent in the area. Was that an embarrassment figure? Did you get that sense as well that we're trying to do this on our own? And Ms. Hicks, I'd like to hear you answer that as well.
I never got that sense.
That was more Ms. Nordstrom. You did have that sense, though.
Again, that was specifically conveyed by the by DAS LAMP to both me and to the prior DCM.
Ms. Thompson, anything to add there?
Nothing in the context of...
Good. Well, I do appreciate it. And again, like I said, this is an issue of truth. You've been providing that. I appreciate it. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you.